Hi, and welcome to this edition of Frequently Asked Questions about Noise, Vibration, and Acoustics. I'm Nick McCabe, a senior engineer and associate at HGC Engineering. In this video series, we answer questions raised by our clients or posed on our website about noise, vibration, and acoustics. There are many situations where normal, routine construction activities take place even very close to the neighbors without concerns related to construction vibration arising. On the other hand, there are situations where construction vibration can be a real concern. So today's question is, when should I be concerned about construction vibration and what can I do about it? Well, there are three factors that play into this, and I will address them each in turn. First, the nature of the planned construction activities. Second, the proximity to nearby buildings. And third, the nature of those nearby buildings. Seems straightforward, and in a sense it is, but each of these factors has a great deal of nuance associated with it, and judgment certainly comes into play. So the first factor is the planned construction activities. People sometimes conflate vibration that is perceptible to the touch with airborne noise that we perceive with our ears. And these are certainly related phenomena, since indoors, vibrating surfaces can radiate noise, and noise can cause the motion of some lightweight surfaces. But there are important distinctions. On some types of construction vibration site in dense areas, an excavation shoring system is needed to retain the sides of an excavation. And a common construction activity used on these sites is the use of a large track drill to auger a vertical hole for the vertical members of this shoring system. And when these machines clear the soil off of their drill, a loud bang is produced that can be heard for blocks and might be annoying, but is not typically correlated with significant ground-borne vibration. Construction activities that do have the potential to create significant ground-borne vibration include things like percussive pile drive. Vibratory driving of piles, or sheet pile segments, or caisson liners, or other materials. Aggressive demolition. Less aggressive demolition, conducted very close to nearby buildings, or sometimes in contact with them. Vibratory compaction of soils or backfill. Rapid ground compaction methods involving dropped weights. And some types of soil augmentation using vibratory or percussive methods. There are certainly others, but these are some that we see frequently. The second factor is the proximity to nearby buildings or structures. Obviously, in a dense urban area, there's sometimes very little room between a construction site and an adjacent building. Sometimes excavation will actually expose a pre-existing shoring wall or foundation wall. And in these situations, it can be very easy to create vibration in a building because work is sometimes done in direct contact with the building. But at greater distances, the nature of the soil begins to play a role. We've seen some situations where the presence of a shelving rock layer or hard ground layer, which rises closer to the surface with greater distance from the site, give rise to situations where higher than anticipated vibration levels occur because the vibration in the soil is constrained in a narrow layer. Finally, the third factor is the nature of the nearby buildings, and this can include several different considerations. First, there are many different construction vibration criteria used around the world. The best of these have some system to differentiate between types of building or structure, recognizing that some buildings or structures will be inherently more sensitive to vibration than others. In addition to the construction materials involved in a building, the age of a building might be a consideration or important factor. Similarly, the presence of a historic designation might imply that greater consideration is warranted. Sometimes, you encounter situations like a tall, slender structure or long, unsupported span, which might give rise to vibration amplification within the building, leading to higher than anticipated vibration levels. Finally, situations arise where the building itself may not be particularly concerning, but the activities within may warrant additional consideration. Research activities involving high sensitivity instrumentation or other activities might imply that greater consideration is needed. Similarly, the presence of a critical data center or certain medical facilities or precision manufacturing may all require special consideration beyond that normally afforded by construction vibration criteria. So what do we do with all of this information? Well, we need to take a look at the anticipated vibration levels at a building, taking into consideration all the information we have, including the nature of the planned construction activities, the proximity to nearby buildings, and the nature of those nearby buildings. Predicted construction vibration should be compared to suitable criteria, and if warranted, construction vibration mitigation measures implemented during construction. The use of a pre-construction condition survey can go a long way to minimizing the scope for future disputes by documenting the existing condition of nearby buildings. During construction, vibration mitigation or monitoring can help to reassure building owners or occupants and to document the actual vibration for due diligence purposes. So thanks for your time. If you have any questions about this subject, about construction vibration, or ideas for future frequently asked questions in this series, please reach out, let us know. Thanks for your time.